But if it is something creative, let's say I take this, right, and I put it apart. So in our outline, I do a lot of copying and pasting of the regulations, for example. So government regulations are not subject to copyright. So that's why you can copy, paste, print HTS US, you can copy, paste, print CFR. Government is for people, right? It's their works are not copyrightable. So, but I take their stuff and I break it out in a more convenient form. So I apply concepts of the general rule, exceptions. I cut stuff out based on the previous examination tendencies. I exclude stuff that I don't think are important. I emphasize that are important through underlining and through making a bold print. I put footnotes, etc., etc. Well, this is creativity, right? And once the creativity kicks in, the copyright becomes becomes viable. So, what else? There is one more. We have copyright, we have patents, we have trademarks, one more. Copyright, we already said. So copyright, patent, and trademark. One more. Not very much talked about. I have a feeling, because there was so much enforcement, I feel like there is a need for me to talk about it. So what's one more? One more is a trade secret. Trade secret is also a Coca-Cola, right? Coca-Cola formula is a trade secret to this day. And if I was to steal that secret, the Coca-Cola consume it. And they can get damages because I took their secret, which was protected, right? So this is also a protectable thing. Although, how can you know it's a trade secret if it was a trade secret, right? How can you tell that to customs? That's a different story. For patents, for copyrights, and for trademarks, trademark especially, customs have a system. They have a system, it's called recordation system. And that recordation system allows customs to be notified of whatever something. So you can register trademark with the trademark office, USPTO, US Patent and Trademark Office. You also register it with customs. So customs is on notice. And based on that information, customs can seize your merchandise or detain your merchandise and inform the copyright owner or the trademark owner that there is certain products which potentially infringe. Do you have a problem with them going through? And if the copyright owner says yes, those are the bad people. Seize the merchandise. He has to post a bond. Because what if it's not really infringing? What if instead of Nike swoosh, right, it is, I don't know, how about a double swoosh? An argument can be made, this is totally a different symbol. So this is question which is most likely beyond the knowledge of customs. Because customs, they know how to enforce provisions, but when you have like a gray, they call gray market good, right? When there is no certain answer of which way to go, you can actually sue that person for having a loss. And if you prevail and saying that this is a different mark, to which you are entitled, you are liable as a trademark owner for damages that person, that importer sustained, because he will have every right to import this product. So to use this intellectual property, you have to have a right to that intellectual property. If you have a right to that intellectual property, you can license it out or you can assign it. So if one thing you can assign, so I own this product. Let's say I am an inventor, I'm a scientist, I made a new toothpaste. I am not a very good at selling this stuff. I just know how to invent it. So I assign my patent to Procter & Gamble, who is very good at marketing this. They pay me money, and then they can license it to everyone else. They become the owner. Everyone sees the concept? So you can assign or transfer the ownership to someone else. And that someone else then can license it out. Meaning that they still keep the rights, but they entitle people to use that mark on the conditions that they deem appropriate or that have been agreed. Everyone follows the difference? Now, on top of that, let me just mention that trademark is governed by Lanham Act. It's the senator back in 1940s. I can totally see this question coming. What type of provision is under what authority can customs seize it? And they put it in their informed compliance publication. There is informed compliance publication about trademarks, and they also mention it in the IPR section of the CFR. So this is for trademarks. Then you have a Copyright Act or Digital Millennium Copyright Act. Not or. Copyright Act and Digital Millennium Copyright Act. So you will know it's copyright. What about patents? What authority does customs have to enforce patents? It is the old, good old Tariff Act, which we all know about. The Tariff Act of 1930 has a special provision called Section 337. For those of you who read the trade news, you probably heard exclusion order. When you hear exclusion order is the provision under Section 337, which a patent owner, such as iPhone producer, Apple, applies to exclude all the merchandise from the market. Exclusion of merchandise from the market not only means exclusion of merchandise from the stores, it also means exclusion of merchandise from being entered into the customs territory of the United States. So customs has a right under that title, under that section of the Tariff Act of 1930, to exclude things. All right? So those are the governing provisions. Those are like a thief, where customs can seize the merchandise and never give it back to you if they find it infringing. So that's it, you lost it. So it's very important for you, if you are the importer, to find out whether this is an infringing mark or not. Because if customs find that this is infringing, then your client will lose the stuff. And it's easy to lose things because you may not mean harm. You didn't know something existed. And by the time you prove it, the lot of time will pass. So this is a real detour about intellectual property rights. So any questions on that before I dive into the actual substance of our discussion, the evaluation? Anyone? All right. So like I said, devil is in the details. And the good place to start. Oh, by the way, everyone, when I say ad valorem, everyone knows that I'm talking about percentage. Ad valorem, it's a Latin term. See, ad valorem right here. Ad valorem is percentage. Sometimes you have a specific duty, such as 4 cents per pencil. Then it's specific. If it's both ad valorem, ad specific, it's called compound rate of duty. Okay, those are the terms that you should be familiar with. But let's start with definitions. The date of export. Let me see if I can make it slightly larger. Date of exportation, time of exportation. So it's a synonymous words. Means the actual date the merchandise finally leaves the country of exportation for the United States. And why is this important? Because, well, for one thing, if you can trying to figure out the currency conversion, that date of exportation will be used for currency conversion. So if it left Italy, and it find in Italy as a country of export, then euros at the time, euro rate to dollar rate at the time of that date will be applied. Oh, welcome. Next, estimate. Haven't seen that much because normally you are dealing with documents, you deal with arrival notices, and you deal with transportation company, which usually maintain a good record of where everything is. So the estimate date is you do not see much, but it is possible. And as I mentioned before, it's critical in determining currency exchange and fair retail value. Because with time, if merchandise is perishable, let's say it's the food, right? After a certain amount of time has passed, that food may no longer be good because it's spoliated. So how do you know? You determine the date of exportation. This is also in line with definitions. There is this form. Customs looks and says, this is not a good value. I think the value should be should have been $20 instead of 15. So the value went up by or $120 instead of $80. So the value went up. What's the procedural mechanism? Well, the procedural mechanism is a form which they send out. They say notice of rate of increase, notice of rate / duty increase, and this is done on CBP form 29. Another form for you in your toolbox to be aware of. If customs decides for whatever reason, if it's change in classification, if it's a change in valuation, if it determines that you need to pay more money to customs, then with CBP form, it must use CBP form 29. Of course, there is a de minimis provision, right? If it's $10, that's why I kind of, when I mentioned $20 example, I restated myself because there is de minimis, right? Aggregate and duties, not the value, but the duties, right? Duties owed exceeds $15. So it also may go for quantity, but the point that this is the threshold. So if it's $10, customs may not worry about it. Liquidation. We talked about liquidation already. Liquidation is found in part 159. Part 159 is for liquidation, and liquidation is defined as final computation of duties. Once you receive this CBP form 29, customs give you the form, say the duty rate is increased. Then customs has short amount of time to liquidate it. Why is that? Well, because this will start your period for protest. Protest is another mechanism which is found in 170 174, part 174 is a protest. What is protest? I'm making a lot of detours because I'll be I think they are relevant to the broader picture. So protest is customs decides this is this costs $10. I say this costs $8. I can challenge customs administratively. Administratively, so there is corollary to administrative would be judicial process. So there is courts and there is administration, right? Administration is customs and border protection. So customs can be challenged within. And the way they can be challenged is filing the form CBP 19. They file a you file a form and you state the reasons why customs is wrong. And you file it with that port, with the port director. So customs can have a second look. The deadline to file protest, to challenge customs on a decision is 180 days from the time of liquidation. This is another reason why liquidation is so important. If 180 days have passed, you passed what is known as statute of limitations. Statute of limitations means you waived your right to protest. Even though if you are right, customs has no jurisdiction to view this claim. Right? So jurisdiction means ability to read the document and look at the facts, look at the substance. And they can't do it because it's day number 181. It used to be 90 days before 2004, so even shorter time. So it's 6 months. In that protest, you challenge customs, and you put forward the reasons, and if you can substantiate your claim based on the law, based on interpretation, based on, let's say, GRIs, that means that they may agree, and they will pay you, give you the refund, and they will give you interest. Because as we shall see, interest begins to accrue after the duties are due. And it continues to be so after it liquidates, because customs did not refund you customs withheld money from you to which you were entitled to. So this is the thing about the protest. Basically, you can protest anything that is adverse to you. It includes classification, it includes valuation, it includes drawback. Anything that you think has been done against you in a bad manner, financially or otherwise, you can protest that. So any amount can be protested, even amount within $20. Okay? And liquidation is a operative factor. This is the day when you can start doing that. So any questions on liquidation? So I have an example here. Example of importation where you will need to declare on CBP form 7501 the country of export, and they have provisions for what the country of export is, and you also need to declare the date of export. And the date of export can be tricky because let's say you have a product, and I had students in the past who actually thought that if you take something from China, bring it to Mexico, and then bring it to the United States, it becomes made in Mexico. So keep in mind that exporting something out and does not make it eligible for that country of origin. There are exceptions, very few exceptions. If you want to write it down, it's Singapore is one of them, Singapore Free Trade Agreement. But outside of that, it's very limited. And you should know why, because really what you're doing is you're shuffling stuff around the world, which is fine. If you want to shuffle your stuff around the world, there may be legitimate reasons for that. Everyone heard of the concept of hubs, right? You have hub and spoke system in the logistic world. Think about anyone booked a flight to other coast, and instead of direct flight, someone landed somewhere in Denver or Texas for to land another flight, which goes somewhere else. You probably heard, if you haven't, you probably heard about that. Why are you, what business do you have in Texas? None. But the way the system is set up by the airlines is in the name of efficiency and the cost. You actually bring one, you bring something together in one hub. And from that hub, everyone else goes. So this is like a transition point. And because airlines go to so many places, this is easier. So there's nothing wrong to bring it to Mexico. So it can go on its way to the United States because logistics company has its hub in Mexico. So it's a legitimate purpose. They have the operation set up where they do everything through Mexico. Same thing with Jamaica. A lot of steamship companies, they have in Jamaica, Kingston, Jamaica, they have a huge port, container yard, where they come in, and if the product is destined to Americas, south or north, they offload containers to the smaller vessels and then go back. And in Jamaica, it gets on another vessel and goes to United States. Here is the situation. If it deliberately left, went to Mexico, deliberately meaning the documents showed, goes to Mexico, nothing was done to the product in Mexico, and then it was brought to the United States, then country of export is Mexico, not China, right? Because it was in Mexico deliberately. Documents show that it goes to Mexico, and for whatever reason, one of the reasons I just described. However, why is it important? Because the country of export is Mexico, right? And export rates determine the rates, exchange rates determined by the export date, right? So the export date, all of a sudden from China, it becomes Mexican for currency exchange purposes. Does everyone see the scenario? But this is not always the case. Remember, I was talking about the situation in Kingston, Jamaica. Oftentimes, if you look at the bill of lading, you will see Haifa, Israel, Houston, Texas. You will not see Kingston, Jamaica. It is implied it is there. So when you purchase bill of lading, when you book something in the bill of lading is a shipping document that says this is the place, this is where it goes. Steamship line, once it's a steamship line custody, they can do whatever they want. They can take it to Iceland, right? If it's for their benefit, right? So you have to really look deep into the scheduling of the system to find out that it actually went to Kingston, and in Kingston it went on a feeder vessel. There is mother and feeder vessel, right? Feeder is a local vessel, and it went to the port of Houston. In that situation, Jamaica is just transshipping point. It's in the regular course of business. It was never meant to be in Jamaica other than just for the purpose of logistical efficiency. If that is the case, even it's just a point where it was transloaded, transloaded another key term, where it was transloaded from one ship to another without else, without entering commerce of Jamaica. In that case, the country of export is still Israel. And I remember when I was, why I speak Israel is because I recently have done a protest for the client for the, with the country of origin Israel, and they it was rejected. And if, as part of protest, usually you have a statement of facts and statement of law, and then the argument. In conclusion, this is just a normal legal writing process. And in a statement of facts, you have to affirm that the country of export is Israel. And how do you affirm? You say, you call up the steamship line and you get certification from them that this merchandise, this container never entered the commerce of Jamaica. And that was enough for them to accept my statements. It's actually not my statements, it's the statement of steamship line, but this is how it works on the ground. So in this way, the country of export will be whatever country that left them in the beginning. Everyone see this concept, how it plays out? Shin, you have any questions? You kind of see where country of export lies? And again, this is important because custom examiner will ask you, what is the how much value to declare? And they give you the facts, and you have to do exchange rate calculation. And they give you a bunch of days. Which day do you use? Well, most likely, you will use the last date of exportation of the country where it left. And without, if you see the statement, oh, it entered into commerce of the third country, then you use that country. All right? I'm moving on. Now, this is somewhat oblique because the term country, again, it's attention to details, but the term country is to be regarded for the purposes of the section as embracing all possessions of a nation, however widely separated, which are object to the same supreme executive, legislative authority and control. So, pretty much remember British Empire, right? It's under control of British Empire. Hong Kong, yeah, well, see, if this was to be true, then you would never declare Hong Kong, you would declare China, right? So it's flexible. Falkland Islands, right? FK? I think it's FK, right? Yeah, FK, not UK. Remember, for United Kingdom, you put GB, right? Well, officially, Falklands are GB, right? Because it's under authority of Great Britain, to control. There was a war back in 1984 over that, because Argentina claimed it right? I don't know how many of you remember this old. Some of you may. I am. So.
Which is almost close to war. Yeah, they fight for 90 days, right? More than 90 days. And they lost two ships.
I do not know the technical aspects. All I know, it was a great boost for Margaret Thatcher. But, oh, you remember, so
yeah.
Once you mentioned the Iron Lady,
yes, exactly.
Things start to come to mind. Okay, well, see, this is important because I never know which, the way our brain works, and people are still discovering this. This is not linear, this is not an outline, right? The way our brain works is we associate stuff with events, and this is how we memorize. So part of my job is here is I can give you this and you can make this too on your own. You can discern this. But if I can spark your recollection to some events and you can associate it with a particular event, which I am telling you or you had experience, then you have a better recollection back in the future, especially during the exam. So thank you for mentioning this. And this is just part of being human, I suppose, right? Okay, so conversion to a foreign currency, date of exportation, and it must be the actual date. We talked about that. basis of appraisement. Notice that it should be 3, 4, 5, instead of 4, 5, 6. I missed 3. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 methods instead of 6. It's a typo on my part. I need to change that. And those are the bases that we'll be dealing with in the coming hour or so.